if we're going to produce something, we need to know the expenses, number one. And if we're going to harvest this production, then we need a marketing department to do the job for us. And that is why I like the National Farm Organization. Matter of fact, I've known more about I.S. Joseph in the last 5 years, and I've known Alver Jean personally in the last 5 years, than I've known Tim Ennis. And it pleases me to know that the National Farm Organization does do business with I.F. Joseph because they are a dedicated company. I've had business transactions of my own handled right through Al, and it's done very, very well. So that is to be applauded. Marketing determines your income, not bigger yields. It's as businesslike as production because you've all made a business of production. America's made a business of production. The government's told you to make a business of production because you all know what fertilizer rates are. You all know what chemical ratios are and which chemicals to use. And you know all what kind of equipment to buy to do that, what kind of labor is needed, and what kind of costs are generated out of it. This is exactly the same thing as marketing, only in a separate field. There's one fault, however, that the farmer has, and we all know what it is. Now, I say fault because it's the psychology, not the reality. He wants to get the highest price that he possibly can independently for that product that he's raising. There's nothing wrong with this, but it spoils a good marketing plan. It puts him on the terms of making marketing a game. It's no different than choosing the color on the wheel in Las Vegas. And because he's making it a game, he is destroying his business. He's making the profit-centered business that he has into a speculatory partnership. For instance, in the wheat reserve, many people, many of my clients, put wheat in the reserve in 1976 and 1977. I advised them to do it. It was a good decision, still is to this day, as we look back on it, 2020. But I had people this year say, I can get $4 for that reserve wheat, but I think I'm going to hold on because I think it's going higher. And the greed starts coming out, you see? And I said, wait a minute. Now, we put that wheat in reserve because we wanted a better price. And $2 or $2.25 was not a fair price. That's right. Okay, we speculated, we put it in the reserve, took the loan out on it, got some storage payments for it. Now it's $4 and you're saying it's going to go higher and you're willing to forfeit the whole business decision you made in 1976 and 1977? Oh no, I didn't say that. I just think the market's going higher. We cashed in. From a professional point of view, we said, take the wheat to town. Profits will keep us in business, not high-range gambling for the highest price. The producer always asks, can the price go higher? A little story. In town, and as a city person, Owl, you're the only one I know that's from a city. Oh, okay. In a city, a lot of times on Saturday or Sunday, Al, don't you go out and wash your car? Once in a while. Vacuum it from the debris of children. Okay, I go out and wash my car occasionally. And I always come back home and the sun's shining and I'll walk in and I'll say, Wendy, who's my wife, she'll say, what? I said, you know what, I think it's going to rain. Well, why do you think it's going to rain? I said, I just washed my car. I know it's going to rain tomorrow. This is my granddad, by the way, coming out at me. And she says, that's foolish. And it is. Farmers have an equal problem to my car washing. They'll go to the elevator in town and finally this tremendous decision. Okay, I'm going to sell my wheat here. And they sell their wheat, and they go back home, and they look at Martha. Martha, the prices are going higher. Well, George, why are you saying that? Because I just sold mine. That's very, very true. It's very, very true. The producer always asks, how high can the market go? My clients always call and say, well, do you think sunflower is going higher? But I have developed the philosophy of not asking how high the prices can go. This sounds like a John F. Kennedy. But how low they can go. Because when we're talking about how high prices can go, everybody has an opinion. Everybody has a positive opinion. And it throws the balance of our marketing plan off. I say, ask how low the price can go, because then you're dealing with reality. You're dealing with the world, and you're dealing with the pessimism that's in a marketplace. And we all know from a marketing standpoint, there's more pessimism in a market, or need I talk about 1977-78 prices any longer, than there is optimism. How low can the price go? For instance, a shoe store operator, he has a line of shoes, women's shoes now, and this is in March. And it's popular. He's got a whole rack of them in the back room, and he's selling them for $10 a pair to keep the prices general. And Easter's coming along, and this is when his sales really increase. Now, he feels that if he can sell these shoes for $10 a pair, and that's fair, could he not put them back in the back room just for a few more weeks and sell them for $15 a pair when Easter comes along? Oh, that's a good plan. I think I'll do that. I'll put these shoes, these popular shoes, for $10 a pair in the back room until 2 weeks before Easter, and I'll bring them out at $15 a pair. And then he thinks, well, maybe that's not such a good idea, because I've got a whole back room of them. What if I take them all out of the back room and sell them for $15 a pair 2 weeks before Easter, and I only sell a quarter of them there? Well, I'll have to bring them out after Easter when they won't be so popular and my sales inventory goes down and it goes back to tennis shoes for the summer, and I'll have to sell them for $5 a pair. Ring any bells? You bet. We can't always be waiting for the $15 shoe to make the bigger money. We have to have a consistent market plan. It has to be dealt with year in, year out, because we don't want to stay in business and make a lot of money this year and then fold up and go home with our tail between our legs in the years to come. We need a business. We want to make our farms a business so that we can farm year in, year out at a good profit. Being satisfied with profits is a very hard thing to do. In reality and philosophy, as I talk here, we can all agree. But to go home and let the rubber meet the road, it's a very difficult thing to do when somebody's saying it's going to go higher. I guarantee you, if you go to the coffee shop and ask that guy that's saying, I think sunflower is going to go to 18 cents, and I heard some of that stuff this year, say, no, wait a minute, Joe, how low do you think prices can go? And then see what he says, because he's not facing reality. How low can the price go? In my business, that's the question we have to ask. So, what I've said is we have to deal in reality. We have to make our farms business, a business. We have to make it profit-centered. We have to have a marketing plan. And we have to have a marketing machine. A marketing machine which is separated and only calculates or uses the expense prices that it costs us to be in farming. And with this, I believe NFO is the place to be. I like it because they're the marketing entity for you, and they're farm-oriented. They are farmers. and I like that. My granddad would get along very well today if he was still in farming with them. I see National Farm Organization as the pilot. As NFO flew me here for this speech, I didn't walk on the plane and give my ticket to the lovely little stewardess who said, your seat's here and I'll be happy to serve you and this kind of thing. I didn't say, hold it. Knock on the cabin door and open it up and say, hey, look, pilot, this is the way I want the ship flown. No, that's where his expertise are. I just walk back and take my seat. I've committed myself to him. And he gets me where I want to go. And I have to have trust in that. And I know who to have trust in. There were two people in a desert in the Texas area, and it was on a road 75 miles apart from another town. And in the middle of it, on a scorching day of about 110 degrees, a passenger family was going down the road, and they were halfway through this desert area, and they saw a man standing on the edge of the road, and he was doing one of these numbers. Like that. And they couldn't understand it. And they looked a little further into the desert, and there was another guy about 50 yards out into the desert, and he was going like this. And the passenger family said, we better stop. Something's wrong here. There's not even a vehicle around here. Something's really wrong. They pulled up real quick to the side of the road and went over to the guy on the edge of the road who was doing this. And they said, what's wrong with that guy out there? Why is he out there? And the guy says, it's hot out here. And they agreed, it's 110. Well, he's lost his marbles a little bit. He's very thirsty and he just doesn't know where he's at. And he thinks he's fishing out there. And the passenger family said, my gosh, we better do something about this. We better go get him. And the guy going like this says, I will as soon as I get this motorboat started. So our trust has to be in the right people, does it not? We have to know who can get us up and bring us down safely and do it at a profit with a consistent plan. And I believe the NFO is this. I've talked about psychology up to this point and we'll conclude in psychology. However, I'd like to talk about sunflower now. The sunflower business. This is going to be old hat for some of you because I'm going to give just a shade of history for it for those who are just interested. What about sunflower? It's the fastest growing crop in the United States. Oh, Randy, but acreage was down last year. Acreage is going to be about the same next year. Total production, harvested acres. And I say no. I say it may be this year, but sunflower is the hottest thing going. It's the fastest growing crop and will surprise us all in the next 10 years. I believe that, and I know it's happening. We have people such as Al over here talking about an announcement in 60, 90 days. We have Cargill, who opened Riverside last year. I've never known Cargill to make too many foolish decisions. We have a good market in Europe. We have had an exciting market in Mexico. And people are just starting to get their taste buds wet with sunflower. In 1978, we produced 1.8 million metric ton or in that vicinity. 79, we doubled it. 3.5, 3.6, Al, million metric ton in the United States. 1980 this year, probably be lucky to have over 2 million metric ton, 2.3, 2.4, I would assume. Yields were down. Acreage was down. But why is the sunflower business growing? From 1974 to 1979, sunflower returned more money per acre than any other Northern Plains crop. It was drought resistant, so to speak, if crops can be such. During the production seasons of 1975 and 1976, sunflower yielded well because of its complex taproot system. It could go to the moisture where moisture was available, deep. Sunflower has a short growing season and combines at harvest rather easily. For those of you who grow it, as long as there isn't any snow on the ground. And it's more easy than most or any other crop. Developing exports in the past 5 years have provided consistent marketing and demand. And demand, my friends, is the key concept, not supply. Demand is what we work with, not supply. The oil product of sunflower is of better quality than any other oil product in the world for human consumption. Has a higher burning point, smokeless, no cholesterol, high in polyunsaturated fats. It's reusable, and right now it may be a very vital link to an energy reserve. Research in the past few years have provided hybrid sunflower. It's not a weed any longer. Improving yields so it can be uniform in stand, head size, and is quickly becoming resistant to various diseases and insects. Unfortunately, it's not resistant to the blackbird yet. Matter of fact, they can't resist. It rotates well with other crops such as corn and wheat and barley, and provides an excellent alternative in northern plains farming. And it also provides a conservation protective because of its heavy stock and mulch. Companies are working very hard on meal use, trying to get the quality of the meal use up to protein standards, which can be done, only it costs a little more money to do. Once we get this area, once we reach a plateau here, then we're going to have a viable product that will begin to replace soybean acres in the next 10 years. Now, we never will replace soybean as a major. However, we will start replacing acreage, especially in the tri-state area. How about the prices? From 1978 to 1979, sunflower traded between 9.5 and 12.5 cents per pound, basis Minneapolis Duluth. In late 79 and early 1980, plummeted. It fell due to the increase in acreage of over 5 million acres last year, a year and a half ago, I should say. Prices traded between 7 and 9.5 cents, basis Minneapolis Duluth. Exports slackened due to the availability of a record soybean crop in the U.S. and Brazil. However, as we've seen, soybeans rally throughout this summer of 1980, we saw the sunflower rally as well before it peaked out in late July, early August. It was due basically to the drought, and prices then rallied to 12 to approximately 13.5 cents per pound, basis Minneapolis Duluth. Fall prices just recently, it's beginning in middle August to late October. Fall prices fell back to 10 to 11.5 cents, basis Minneapolis Duluth, and now have rallied back to 11.5 to 13 cents, basis Minneapolis Duluth. Because of the vegetable oil glut in the world due to high production in soybeans in 1979 and 1980, sunflower in 78 and 79, and Malaysian palm oil in 1978 through 1980, we have experienced lower prices and lower ranges. However, buyers and exports alike are now realizing a reduced carryover in supply in the coming year. Soybean carryover for next year will be half the size. They're projecting 160, I believe, million bushel for the U.S., which is half or a little less than half than what we've had this year in 1980 period as a carryover. Both, however, in sunflower and soybean will the carryover be reduced, and this is vital to higher prices. The vegetable oil, although plentiful now, will grow greater in demand in the summer of 1981. There is no doubt that we're in a glut of vegetable oil in the world currently. As soybeans continued this summer to put on contract highs and go higher, the soybean oil was shaking 200 points behind. But my rationale for higher prices and for a vegetable oil demand in the world in the summer of 1981 is based on these reasons. Recent purchases of oil by the Soviets, they have confirmed and rumored 45,000 tons of Argentine linseed oil, 50,000 tons of French rapeseed oil, 100,000 ton of Philippine coconut oil, and 15,000 ton of Malaysian palm oil. Somewhat unlike the Soviets. These sales have firmed current markets, including sunflower, and affirmed the supply-demand relationships of oil for long-term. Soybean oil, for one, in the last move by soybeans to attempt for the soybean to break its Chicago futures contract high, the oil was leading the way. Acreage for oilseed crops will not increase much for 1981. As I've already said, the sunflower acreage will remain about the same for 1981. Soybean acreage may increase slightly, but the corn and wheat will replace a soybean growth. Corn will increase and wheat will increase in the U.S. vitally. Kansas, Oklahoma, and Texas have already increased in wheat rapidly. I think there are record plantings in Kansas, especially for winter wheat. Sunflower will remain the same, as I said, due to the wheat and barley in the northern plain states, also a variety of other crops and prices, and durum, I might bring up. Foreign markets will continue to upgrade the diets due to the trade of the American dollar. This, again, goes with something I said in the dry bean seminar, and that is that Mexico is returning their dollars in food because they want to upgrade their diet in Mexico. So their dollars are being well spent in America. Therefore, vegetable oil demand will increase long term. Sunflower prices in the U.S. will provide greater profit potential in 1981 and in the 1982 period than they did this year. That's on a firm professional analysis. That's not just meandering with what I think the price is going to do, and I think that it's going higher. We already have, I was talking to Al, we have 13-cent contracts offered already for new crop. I think the April-May delivery was at 14 and a quarter, 14.50, as I noticed the other day. So we do have firm potential out there. What is happening? What is happening in terms of my firm? What are we suggesting? We're suggesting increasing sunflower acreage this year. Why? Because everybody else is increasing wheat. Every farmer I talk to has saved back some reserve wheat, seed wheat I'm talking about, to plant because the wheat price is in the $4.390 area, basis the Red River Valley area. And this is the area they want to go. They want to raise grass. It's easier. Corn has been a vital link in South Dakota and North Dakota this year for people who used to raise it and now came back into it. We're experiencing 6 and 7 year old prices again in the corn. This is the highest it's been for 6 and 7 years. This is going to keep acreage into the feed grain complex and wheat complex. Sunflower acreage, the yields were down a little bit this year because of drought. We had a lot of first-timers in the sunflower market this year that were discouraged because of that. The old-timers are going to stay with it, but it's going to keep acreage at about what we had last year. This will provide some uncertainty in the market for next summer. Uncertainty in terms of how much acreage is really out in the tri-state area. Uncertainty due to commitments already made in the export market, and uncertainty due to the production or productivity. What will the harvest really return? How many pounds per acre? And this will keep prices supported and very firm. We may find a relapse in prices early in the year, but would be constructed to get commitments toward spring area. uncertainty. And if I leave you with anything out of my sunflower talk or commodity talk, uncertainty always yields higher prices. Certainty always yields lower prices. I'll give you an example. When the Soviets are messing in our markets, tick-tocking, asking about commodities, buying, purchasing, it's the rumor, it's the uncertainty, it's the not the knowledge that we have of certainty that makes prices go higher. Whenever you hear Russian comments, the market normally will drift or move higher. However, I've had clients call in, and over the radio they'll hear that the Soviets have purchased maybe 2 million metric ton of wheat. And to the farm level, this says, well, if the Soviets are in our market, it must mean prices are going to go higher. However, they'll call in a few days and say, didn't the Soviets just buy 2 million metric ton of wheat? I'll say, yes. Well, why are the prices lower? Because it was certain when they purchased, finally, the wheat, it became common knowledge. It was certain. There was no more rumor within. And that's what a marketplace is, and that's what you have to deal with. You've all been at an auction, have you not? And let's say there's a pewter lamp base at an auction. It's foggy, it's drizzly, it's in the middle of the week, it's on a Wednesday, it's cold, chilly, and hardly anybody's there. And you see this pewter lamp, and you know that that's worth some money, and the bidder and the auctioneer finally gets to it, and people start bidding, and you watch it, and somebody walks away with that pewter-based lamp for $6.50, and you go back home and you say, I can't believe it. That was a pewter-based lamp, an old antique, and it went for $6.50. However, you take the same auction and put it on a sunny day, warm weather, on a Saturday where the weekenders are out, and you may have a few antiquers looking at the farm sale, and it's well advertised, and it's just a good day to be among people. And the talk's going and the sun's shining, and the auctioneer comes to that same lamp, and my gosh, somebody walks away with that lamp for $40. And you can't believe it. What was the difference? What was the difference? That's what the market is like in Chicago in the futures market. That's what the market's like in Minneapolis. That's what the market's like in Chicago and New York, Kansas City and New York. That is a marketplace. All it is an auction. It doesn't necessarily always have to deal with reality. It deals with attitude and personality. Which brings me to my conclusion. And to give you an idea of what my conclusion's about, I was up in Fargo last week at the university. They had an agriculture show there. And I pulled in late in the afternoon back home. We'd driven because we had a booth. We had to take all the supplies up there. And I pulled into the driveway and I noticed a sign that I'd never seen in my driveway before. And it said, for sale, dog, $50,000. And I could tell it was my little boy's handwriting. And I went inside and, you know, this is pretty comical, right? And I said, Benji! What's the sign out there? And he says, Papa, I'm selling my dog. Well, I know it's your dog and you can sell it if you want to. That's fine, but $50,000. No sweat, Dad. No sweat. I said, you'll never get it. He says, well, didn't you tell me that you can sell things sometimes for what they're not worth? And I said, oh, yeah. Sometimes I ask Benji, what do you like to do? Go long or short the corn market for the day? 75%, he's always right. I had to trade his guesses. So I just said, okay, you do what you do and we'll see what happens. And the next day I drive back from work, late afternoon, and the sign is gone. Kid's giving up, right? The old man's right. I went inside and Ben, did you sell your dog? And he had a big smile and he says, you bet I did, Papa. And then I thought, well, he sold it for less. And I didn't see the dog. I said, well, how much did you sell it for? He says, I sold it for $25,000 cats. The market-oriented farmer has a lot to deal with. And if he's going to set up a marketing business, if he's going to have his own marketing department, you see, he has to get out of his productivity, his production side. And it has to be intelligent, and it has to deal with reality. And he has to plug into people he can trust. The Quad Cities on the Illinois side has a track. I was over there one day standing in line, two people in front of me, and I heard the lady say to her husband, you know, kind of quiet, she said, and I didn't mean to overhear her, she said, Ray, I hope we break even. We're buying our tickets, right, for the bet, for the race. And I said, lady, I didn't mean to overhear you, but you said to your husband that you just wanted to break even. And she says, yes, yes, sir. And I said, why? I'm here to make some money, aren't you? She says, oh, yeah. Well, I said, well, then why did you say to your husband you just want to break even? She said, we need the money. We can't break even in the market to stay in business. We have to have the marketing department. We have to deal with profits. We have to know what is break even and then make money from that. A marketing department. Well, who is the market-oriented farmer? Who is he? He should be every one of you. Every one of you. What is he? Concerned about a profit on his mass food production line. What he does, he selects various respectful inputs of information, NFO. Objective, not a broker, not a commissionable man standing on the futures in the futures pit, but somebody that says, I love the farmer. I am a farmer. Number three, what he is, what he does. He relies upon marketing year-round. It's not a seasonal thing. He doesn't go out and produce a crop and then come in and worry about the markets. NFO. They are marketing year-round. They have a marketing plan. A marketing plan that succeeds. What he does. Number four, he's flexible. Willing to use his farm operation and grain handling, livestock operation, to produce a profit, no matter what that flexibility entails. NFO. Number five, knows his future cash flow. Your wives, I want to see you poke every one of your husbands in the ribs here. Because it's always the woman that knows what the bottom line is. Key. That is the machinery you have to buy as a farmer. Knowing what your cash flow is and what the bottom line is. And marketing around that. Not how high can the price go. Number six, what he does. He reorganizes his method by asking, can prices go lower? Let's touch base with reality here. We can all talk about the most positive things in the marketplace. The market-oriented farmer, what he does. Number seven, he becomes satisfied with his sales. The hardest part, it's not a car wash situation. You don't know prices are going higher because you just washed your car? Right? No. Just because you sell your grain at this, if it's a profit, we're satisfied with it. We're staying in business because we're going to be here to buy our neighbors out. Number 8, market-oriented farmer and what he does is current with the world events, and that makes him a good marketer. And that's where NFO is also a foundation for the farming community. Overall, the market-oriented farmer is a farmer who's created a marketing department for his farm, and it's already been formed and created for you, sitting here at Cincinnati, sitting at Corning, Iowa. I want to read you something that has made a lot of sense to me the more I think about it. The first time I heard it, I wasn't sure I agreed with it. Now I am coming to grips with the reality of what it has to say. And if you'll just listen, I promise to quit. Bart Starr said the greatest lesson he learned from Vince Lombardi had nothing to do with football. He told us the quality of a man's life is in direct proportion to his commitment to excellence, no matter what his chosen field of endeavor is. And there's an article written by Vince of the following that's titled "The Habit of Winning." Winning is not a sometime thing. You don't win once in a while. You don't do things right once in a while. You do them right all the time. Winning is a habit. Unfortunately, so is losing. There is no room for second place. There is only one place in my game, and that's first place. I have finished second twice in my time at Green Bay, and I don't ever want to finish second again. There is a second place bowl game, but it is a game for losers played by losers. It is and always will be, or has been, an American zeal to be first in everything we do, and to win, and to win, and to win. Every time a football player goes out to the field, he has to play from the ground up, from the soles of his feet right down to his head. Down in my case. Every inch of him has to play. Some guys play with their heads. That's okay. You've got to be smart to be number one in any business. But more important, you've got to play with your heart, with every fiber of your body. If you're lucky enough to find a guy with a lot of head and a lot of heart, he's never going to come off the field second. Running a football team is no different from running any other kind of organization, an army, a political party, a business, a farm. The problems are the same. The objective is to win, to beat the other guy. Maybe that sounds hard or cruel. I don't think it is. It is the reality of life that men are competitive, and the most competitive games draw the most competitive and independent men. That's why they're there to compete. They know the rules and the objectives when they get in the game. The objective is to win fairly, squarely, decently, by the rules, but to win. And in truth, I have never known a man worth his salt who is in the long run, deep down in his heart, did not appreciate the grind, the discipline. There is something in good men that really yearns for, needs, discipline and harsh reality of head-to-head combat with the world. I don't say these things because I believe in brute nature of man, or that men must be brutalized to be combative. I believe in God and I believe in human decency, but I firmly believe that any man's finest hour, his greatest fulfillment to all he holds as dear, is the moment when he has worked his heart out in a good cause and lies exhausted on the field of battle victoriously. And I agree with that. I say amen to that. And I don't know of another organization besides my own that's farmer-oriented, that doesn't care to get caught up in the industry, doesn't care to get into the complex business world, but wants to stay at the farm level for farmers, because this is our building here. This country was discovered on our money. as the NFO. They've got their minds in it. They're good people. From the sunflower industry, you have Tim, you have Alvergene, and many, many, many people behind that scene, all of which consist of NFO. But more importantly, they have their heart in it, and they can do a good job year in, year out. Thank you very much for the opportunity.
Thank you, Randy. I'd like to just make a few closing comments, particularly of interest were Randy's comments in regard to the encouragement to produce more sunflowers. I think some of these same feelings and remarks, independent of what Randy had to say, have been talked about between myself and among members here in regard to buckwheat and millet and some of the other commodities also that we're seeing some real strong prices in now. I want to just make some comment on the fact that we feel that a professional relationship with a firm like RWA Financial Services or with buyer firms experts in exporting like I.S. Joseph Company are firm professional relationships. And Randy knows and Al know that there's very often when we're in our business dealings that we have exactly the opposite opinions of what certain facts mean and different aspects of the way things are going and what's possible and all that. I don't in any way want to leave an impression that in the specialties department or in this organization that on the one hand we want to turn our decision making over to someone else. On the other hand, we're important enough, the members are important enough that we want to draw on the opinions and information that's available from other people. Sometimes we get caught up in the day-to-day activities of NFO to the point that we get into a vacuum, we get blinders on like the horse, and we want to expand the sources of information, the sources of opinions, something to butt up against and our own ideas and where we're going to give us better direction. And the emphasis in the specialties department is in the fact that the people that we want as our staff, our first and primary thing is towards NFO roots. I'm proud of the staff that we've got together in the specialties department of NFO. I mentioned some of them here earlier, and we consider them professionals in a different but equally professional way in terms of people like Delton Minder and Warren Doubles and Bob Lewis. We're professional at what we're trying to do in service in you. We want to become more professional. I'd like to mention two people that are a close part of my staff at the home office who have years and years of NFO experience that when it's tied with the experiences of bargaining and marketing that we're going through on a day-to-day basis, I think is a irreplaceable combination. We've seen Doris McElwain, who's been with the organization for a long time. People out of Minnesota know her very well, in the organization in different capacities. I'm proud to have her on my staff at the home office with her years of experience, and now with some training under her belt to do the millet part of our specialties operation. I'd like to introduce her. She's in the front row here. I consider her just as important to staff as these people in the field. Also, I want to announce for those of you who haven't heard or seen it in any of the NFO publications that starting the last couple days of September, we've taken on Norb Connor, who some of you may know. He's a longtime NFO person. He's been a national director out of the state of Wisconsin at times. His experience is in the area of dairy. But he has valuable experience, and he's our new key man in the edible beans. And he's a key man in terms of working with me along with Doris and these people in the field for advice as far as where do we go, what do, how do we do it better. And we're listening every day to input that you people put into these people in the field. We consider them equal members in our staff in terms of making good long-range decisions for you. So I don't want to overemphasize the idea that we're looking to someone else to make decisions. But I do want to emphasize that we have a need for more professional advice and analysis than we can take to do on a day-to-day basis. And this is where I see a firm like Randy Allen's plugging in and having a benefit to 800 or 1,000 producers in our sunflower program all at one time. This is where I see the benefit of you having the ability to have contact with Al Vergine, who has his own interests of IS Joseph Company, which are very closely tied over these growing years of the last 8, 6, 8, 10 years. We both have...